Hi, Douglas Watkins here to walk you through the web version of the population genetics simulation used in lesson 8 of the natural selection and evolution unit for OpenSciEd high school biology. The application just looks like this when you open it up and when students access it through their computer simulation handout. The link will be right here on top. And the first thing students are asked to do is to just explore the simulation. And so just to quickly walk through and familiarize you with what the most important aspects are of the simulation are with respect to lesson 8 and the unit in general, are the population data, specifically the N size, is going to be really important for our investigation in this lesson. The number of populations and generations, the frequency of one of the alleles, and the fitness is important. We're not going to change it or ask students to change it, but they could if they explored it. It'll be important that after students explore and you have a conversation about it, that we get these back to all the same fitness so that we can describe the changes in the population genetics as occurring randomly. Migration will come into play. Mutation, inbreeding, inbreeding and bottleneck will all be available to students if they want to explore, but they aren't necessary to get where we need to be in lesson 8. Of particular importance for you and for students will be this blue info button. When you open that up, you'll find that the author of this simulation has put together a great collection of information related to all the different pieces, the manipulations within the app. I strongly suggest that you read through this first in order to be best prepared to support students when they explore the simulation and then use it. So the next part of the handout students use asks them to create a finite population that reproduces over 400 generations. And so that's kind of all just how it sets up automatically. Students can explore whether or not they want to have one population or more. Remember, the purpose of this simulation and where we are in lesson 8 is that students have just figured out that the bear populations, when they investigate bears and coyotes, the bear populations have become very fragmented due to urbanization across the Americas. And we've learned throughout the unit that there are specific genetic data pieces that we can use to describe how populations change, and we want to investigate or simulate what might happen to the bear populations given their decreased size and fragmentation over time. So we may just want to have one population here. Students may want to explore with multiple. The table here is editable. You should feel free to change it however you want, but really the key take-home points are we want to record how many populations are we simulating? What's the starting size of every population? And the big take-home data point here is the allele frequency for A1 and A2. And so if I just run one population, 400 generations, and click go, we find that it immediately puts together a nice graph for me. And over here is I'll always have an infinite population. And so that's kind of cool to have students notice that the infinite population, depending on your allelic frequency to start and the fitness levels, but given it starts at 50% and equally fit, if the population went infinite, it would stay at 0.5. However, over time, this one simulated to become A2 was the only allele that remained after 355 generations. And this particular population completely lost its A1 allele. So we can just click go over and over, and it'll simulate different outcomes. That's the change in A1 and A2 allele frequencies, and students can record those ideas here. They can change the population number to be very small, like the bears, and maybe we have 5 populations of bears that are much smaller. And I click that, and oh, we see that the allelic frequency goes to 1 or 0 super fast when I have small populations. Let's say the bear populations were 1,000 big, and there's 5 of them, so they're fragmented but large. We have no migration here. This is where migration starts to come into play. And we notice that, oh, sometimes some of the alleles reach 100% or 0%, but it's more likely over multiple simulations that we maintain allelic diversity. Remember, this simulation is only concerned with A1 and A2, but we can use this to make claims about multiple alleles within a genome. If I change my 1,000 to 100 and simulate, now I'm starting to see in almost every outcome at least one population completely losing one of the alleles. And so now I can start to make claims about fragmented population size and differences across the fragmented populations genetically. If I reach a certain number, like 10, or let's just try 50, and I run it. Now, look at that. I'm still getting to either all ones or zeros by 400 generations. I'm losing allelic diversity every time. So 50 is too small, maybe 60, and students can experiment with these numbers. And they can record it in their data tables. They're asked to, after this first round of exploration and data collection, find that number that resulted in always a major loss in diversity. And so, I don't know, 70 looks pretty good. It's almost all of the populations getting to A1 or A2 at 100% or 0% in every sim. And then we add migration. And this is where you're going to want to really rely on this info in the info page. It describes for you and for the students the difference between the two simulated migration types. And now we can compare, what does migration do? How small can my population get and be fragmented? As long as there's migration and we don't lose allelic diversity. The handout students complete asks them to make claims about this original data. We describe the importance, or ask students to think about the importance of these fitness levels here, because at the end of the day, this simulation is about genetic drift, and we want to make sure, and bottlenecking, so we want to make sure that we have chance changes over time and not selection pressures. We add the migration bit, and students are asked by the end of the handout to predict, given all the genetic data they just simulated, what might happen to coyotes and what might happen to bears if the urbanization practices we currently use as humans remain the same. To give you a little bit of guidance for what students could possibly put into their data tables and how they could answer some of these questions, you'll find a computer simulation sample document where we have some suggested or sample student responses to a lot of the prompts and some sample data that students could potentially put into their simulated experience. What you'll want to do as the instructor is familiarize yourself with really at what levels would you expect to find allelic diversity maintained, whether that be population size, migration type, migration rate, and so on. I would recommend reading up on these sample responses here for the end of the handout so that you can be best prepared to support the discussions in class.